As human beings, we are free. Free to love, to hate, to fight, to kill. This freedom is found in every living person on this planet. There is no one person more powerful than the other. Only the one with the most will is the strongest. Height, weight, physical appearance, none of these things matter. The only thing that matters is your mind. The question then becomes, are you the type of person who can summon their power at will?
This is a ranger chokehold. You will lose consciousness in 20 seconds. Defend yourself. Defend yourself.
What did you do wrong?
Didn't defend myself.
No. Once that happens, it's too late to defend yourself. Stand up. Move.
Hello, Canada and the world at large. This is Lane from Canada. This video was supposed to be an episode of Post Before Movies Sucked, and I was going to be reviewing the Barbie movie. Now, the Barbie movie sucks harder than a morbidly obese person creating vacuum suction on the seat of an airplane toilet and then accidentally flushing it with their overflowing arm fat. But I had this idea about satirically reviewing it as the greatest psychological horror film in history. I had a full review written up and I was diving deep into how it was not only about enslaved Kens versus evil Barbies, but also evil Barbies brainwashing possibly innocent Barbies into joining the ranks of the evil Barbies, and how these newly evil Barbies now honestly believe that they're the good Barbies. My conclusion was that Barbieland was a more evil fictional kingdom than any previously seen throughout the history of literature, as the brainwashing powers of the evil Barbies prevent even themselves from knowing who is truly good or evil, removing the concept of free will from both the Barbies and the Kens. That would mean Barbieland is a truly godless dimension wherein the power of creation has finally been given fully into the hands of only an ultimate form of evil, and that's a darkness that even the most twisted authoring minds of horror fiction have rarely ventured into. The problem is that the Barbie movie is also straight up demonic to the point that I realized I didn't even want to watch it again long enough to assemble a bunch of clips into a YouTube video. At some point, things become so evil that they're not even worthy of satire, but only straight up mockery. I'm reminded of the story of the prophet Elijah on Mount Carmel, when he challenged 850 child-sacrificing prophets of Baal to call upon Baal to send fire from heaven onto their sacrifice. When it didn't happen, the God of Israel incinerated Elijah's sacrifice, reducing it down to
liquid hot magma.
And then Elijah captured and slaughtered all 850 prophets of Baal. But don't worry, they're a bunch of satanic scumbags who killed babies to win Baal's favor in the hopes of attaining a bountiful harvest. Screw them! The real takeaway from that story is not what Elijah did with his sword, but what he did before that, while the heathen prophets were still desperately calling on Baal to rain down fire. He didn't playfully satirize them. He stood on Mount Carmel and mocked the ever-loving shit out of them, just like we should encourage men and women of all ages to do to the Barbie movie. Short version, we're reviewing an actual psychological horror film featuring a more likable hot blonde from the 1950s who wears cute summer dresses. Welcome to Before Movies Sucked, and this is Final Girl. I'm still thinking about the Barbie movie and it's annoying me. Here's a more likable bear cub making friends with a fawn. Okay, that helped. I'm gonna be really straight with you guys on this one. We are officially back into even bad movies used to be good territory, and this is probably the most indefensible movie I'm ever gonna attempt to defend on this channel, which should really tell you something about how much the Barbie movie sucks. Dumb fun can cover a lot of sins in this film, but the dumb and final girl is beginning to tilt the scales beyond what the fun may be able to fully counterbalance. This movie is bad, and I love it. I just have to tweak it a little. In the late 1940s, a mysterious agent named William interviews a precocious young girl named Veronica. Veronica's parents were killed in an accident, but she shows an apathetic acceptance of their deaths, suggesting that she's either a bit sociopathic or on the autistic spectrum. She also has innate puzzle-solving abilities and a photographic memory. William invites Veronica to join him in a secret government program which trains gifted children to become undercover operatives for dangerous missions. With the caveat of unlimited ice cream, Veronica accepts. 12 years later, Veronica has grown into a beautiful young woman trained in various forms of combat by William. He reveals that Veronica's first solo assignment will be an unarmed infiltration into a gang of rich boys, Jameson, Shane, Nelson, and Danny, who are suspected of being serial killers. Why does she have to be unarmed? If I had to guess, I'd say it's because the idea of Veronica being a government operative was a late addition to the script, and this was originally just planned to be a girl fights back movie. However, for the sake of my headcanon, I'm saying it's because Veronica's being trained as a femme fatale spy as much as an assassin, so William needs to see how well she can handle her own womanly wiles in the field, not just a Colt M1911. Did I mention this movie is almost indefensible? The boys have made a game of inviting young women on formal dates, advising the girls to dress in their finest clothes while the boys always wear tuxedos. Once in the woods, the girls are forced to flee while the psychotic gang hunts them down and kills them like game. Veronica and William surveil the boys at their favorite diner, and Veronica ingratiates herself with Shane's unwitting girlfriend, Jennifer. She learns that the boys are at a risk of a major falling out, in part due to jealousy over Jennifer and Shane's relationship. As part of Veronica's training, William administers her a chaos cocktail of DMT and sodium pentothal, which simulates extreme combat fatigue and disorientation, while also forcing the victim to face vivid hallucinations of their deepest fears. Veronica hallucinates battling an unbeatable enemy until she is rescued by William. However, William tells her that she has failed and must be cut from the program. Veronica protests that she has fallen in love with William, but he executes her. Veronica awakens and recovers from the drug, but is troubled by the cost of her own failure. In their hotel that night, Veronica offers herself to William, who admits that he is attracted to her as well. However, he insists that they cannot have a relationship due to their professional responsibilities, as well as his own memories of his wife and daughter who were murdered before he became an agent. Veronica baits Jameson in the diner, knowing his affinity for young blonde women. She agrees to meet him for a date on Saturday night and prepares herself in a beautiful red dress and red lipstick, as Jameson had requested. Fearing that she'll be killed on the mission, Veronica leaves a love note for William on the mirror before leaving. Jameson introduces Veronica to his gang, and they spend a raucous evening smashing mailboxes before driving to a remote campsite in the woods. Veronica offers them a drink from her flask, which she has spiked with the chaos cocktail, but only Jameson abstains. During a game of truth or dare, Veronica is dared to slap Danny, kiss Jameson, and have her hands bound. When Jameson draws her next option, it is revealed that they plan to kill her. The gang mocks Veronica's screams for help.
Help! Can anyone save me?
We're in the woods. Nobody can hear you.
Scream all you want.
Now, Veronica, what's 360 degrees divided by 4?
90.
None of us know which direction you go, which means each of us will have 90 degrees of ground to cover. The farther you go, the more land we have to track. Personally, I like your chances. But you have to keep running. 5 minutes. Run, Rabbit.
Run!
We'll give her, what, 4 more minutes?
Ah!
Ooh, someone's a little antsy.
Yo, if he's not waiting, I'm not.
Don't forget the booze. Let the games begin.
Veronica's panicked tears appear to be real as she strips off her bonds and high heels, but she calms herself by remembering William's words about how survival is a matter of training and willpower. Danny discovers Veronica first, but as the chaos cocktail kicks in, he visualizes her as his greatest fear, which is apparently Mama Panda's all-you-can-eat buffet. Oh yeah, and then this happens!
Come on, you Babylonian whore!
Did he really just say that?
Come on, you Babylonian whore!
Dudes in the 1950s went full Old Testament when they went blue.
You Babylonian whore!
Once wasn't enough. That's like the best insult you can throw at a woman.
It's horrifying. I'm so sorry.
Oh yeah, and then this happens.
We don't have to keep doing this.
I think we do.
In a series of conveniently one-on-one confrontations, Veronica battles and kills Danny, Nelson, and Shane, in the process realizing their deepest fears. The insecure Nelson fears being betrayed by the others and seems to want to have sex with his mom. Shane is afraid that Jennifer has been having an affair with Jameson, which is strongly implied to be true. And Danny is afraid of weird panda people because he's just crazy. Exhausted by her battle with Shane, Veronica is found by Jameson, but he applauds her for surviving and allows her time to recover. He boasts that he will have killed 21 girls after dispatching Veronica, but alternatively offers to marry her and make her his new crime partner. When she turns him down, they engage in a ferocious fist fight, but Veronica's lifetime of training eventually allows her to defeat him. She knocks him out using a chokehold she learned from William, and forces him to ingest the remnants of the chaos cocktail. Jameson awakes with a noose tautened around his neck, standing precariously on a tree stump. Veronica taunts him with his own words about how people will always call on God in their final moments, regardless of what they claim to believe in life. Jameson begins crying, begging her to set him free, and promising to never harm another girl. However, the chaos cocktail overwhelms him, and he hallucinates the ghosts of his previous victims approaching from the woods, leading to a fairly understandable meltdown. As the ghost of a murdered girl named Gwen advances on him, Jameson stumbles back from the stump and hangs himself. William immediately approaches Veronica and congratulates her on completing her training. He takes her to the diner for the ultimate breakfast of champions, pancakes, and they share another flirtatious moment, implying that they might be ready to begin a relationship. I enjoyed this movie way more than I thought I would when I watched it for the first time, as I was convinced that it was being made with tongue firmly in cheek. Then I made the mistake of watching some behind-the-scenes footage and realized the filmmakers were as deadly serious as the amount of fentanyl in George Floyd's bloodstream at the moment he died. That actually impacted my enjoyment of it, as I now have to watch it with my own tongue in my own cheek, and do some mental gymnastics and even a little bit of video editing to justify my own headcanon. First of all, this movie was not shot in black and white, but I realized years ago that's the best way to watch it. Like I said, you have to tweak this one a little. There are a few nice touches about watching the movie in color, most notably Veronica's platinum blonde hair and her matching red dress and lipstick, which really give her the vibes of a classic pinup girl. Women were just hotter in the 50s, I didn't make the rules. However, a lot of the lighting techniques herald back to a more primitive time in filmmaking, including several scenes that use a simple spotlight to illuminate the characters, resulting in harsh shadows that most modern films would never allow. I'm not sure if this was an aesthetic choice by the cinematographer or if the movie just had a budget of about $8, but the effect somehow works as a time machine. This technique is most notable when William first meets Veronica, when Nelson has dinner with his mother, and again when Nelson has his final battle with Veronica. Watching in black and white really feels like you're experiencing a low-budget film from the 50s or 60s, and even that somehow makes its many shortcomings more forgivable. It's kind of like Psycho if Alfred Hitchcock had been forced to film his entire masterpiece for $8. The guy who made this film ain't Alfred Hitchcock. Let's take Jameson's death, for example. Any skilled filmmaker could have done a similar scene with equal emotional impact as the finale for any manner of film, but a skilled filmmaker might have actually remembered that when you're hanging a character from a tree, you actually need to include a tree. Seriously, where's the tree? We basically get a 360-degree view of the surrounding area, and the only tree is the lopped-off remnant that Jameson is standing on, with his noose magically suspended from skyhooks. I love that when he steps off the stump, you can actually see a wall of accumulated water falling down from the very long crane arm that he's obviously suspended from, as it's shaken by his fall. This tells us that if he's actually supposed to be hanging from a tree, its trunk is at least 30 feet away and it has one branch that extends at least 40 feet straight out in order to still be strong enough to support Jameson's weight. They straight up forgot the tree! I love movies! I actually reviewed a couple of scenes out of sequence. In the actual movie, the scene where Veronica attempts to seduce William takes place immediately before she takes the chaos cocktail. But one thing I'm almost certain of was that in the original script, Veronica's seduction took place immediately after that. There are a few reasons to believe this is the correct sequence. First of all, when William is preparing to administer the drug to Veronica, there is a playful moment where he tickles her, which felt out of place after their awkward encounter in the hotel room, where he had to remind her of their professional boundaries. He most likely says this as a reminder to himself as much as to Veronica, as the tickling really was a flirtatious act. Also, Veronica mentions having a headache in the hotel, which is likely an after effect of the drugs. Lastly, it makes a lot more sense that she would suddenly attempt to win William's affections after a disturbing hallucination of him killing her, and after realizing that he really could be ordered to kill her one day if she scrubs out of the program. Or maybe I'm just a better writer than whoever wrote and edited this. Who knows? Again, a bit of tweaking is necessary for maximum enjoyment, and in my own re-edit of the film, yes, I do that, I've swapped these two scenes, which I think makes the movie a lot more coherent. A bit like the Barbie movie, Final Girl is more enjoyable when you completely ignore most of what the filmmakers intended. The good news is that's pretty easy to do, because the filmmakers failed so horrifically in their intentions in both cases. Suffice it to say, this is the only movie Tyler Shields ever directed, and I'm pretty sure that's a good thing. Remember that photo of Kathy Griffin holding up President Donald Trump's severed head? That photo was his idea. Brilliant stuff there, Tyler. Trump won and you know it. With these kind of hurdles to jump through, movies like this are carried to the finish line almost entirely based on the performances and unintentional humor. Final Girl had an even greater challenge in that regard, as I'm starting to suspect that I might actually be a better actor than Wes Bentley, and I can't act at all. He's still an appealing and very handsome actor, enough that you fully buy into Veronica's infatuation with him, but this does seem to be one of those tough guy roles that one accomplishes merely by never unclenching one's eyebrows. Alexander Ludwig gets a more relished role as the villainous Jameson, who truly sells the delight his character takes in hunting girls for sport. He's charismatic and charming, and it's not surprising that so many young women have been enticed by him in the past. Even his final offer to marry Veronica during their final fight is in keeping with his nature, as it almost feels like all of his hunts have been a twisted search for the one woman who can actually impress him. Cameron Bright as Shane is kind of the weak link in the killer gang. Remember Cameron Bright? That cute little kid that was in every movie that needed a cute little kid in the mid-2000s? Then he hit puberty and gave the performance that he gives in this movie and was basically never heard from again. Rhys Thompson as Nelson fares better, being the one villain who hints at a more complicated past as opposed to just being the creepy guy with Oedipal feelings towards his mom. At the dinner scene, his mother references that his father doesn't get to eat her cooking in the mess hall, and Nelson gets a disquieted look. This suggests that his father is in the military, and it could be implied that Nelson's violent tendencies stem from both his jealousy and his misguided attempts to impress a more masculine father figure. That's a moment that could have been expanded on, but even so, it sets up Nelson's insecurity quite well. It is further seen in his fight with Veronica, where his greatest fear is revealed to be betrayal by the other members of his gang. Rhys Thompson is an actor that I first saw in the satirical noir film The Assassination of a High School President, and it's always surprised me that his career never really took off. Final Girl is a mediocre film at best, and Nelson is still the most intriguing character in it. However, the standout from the gang definitely goes to Logan Huffman as Danny Boy, who gives a truly demented performance. It's not exactly subtle acting, but the scene where he dances with his beloved axe is one of the most memorable in the film, and it's almost a shame that he's the first of the killers to be picked off by Veronica. This is the kind of character who should have killed off the more straight-laced Jameson to make himself the last man standing. That would have amped up the fun of the movie by a few more notches. See what I mean? I actually like this movie, and even I'm close to becoming a movie critic on this one. Whatever. It's better than me having to exercise your kids because they picked up a legion or two at the Barbie movie. Not today, Satan! Abigail Breslin is the real reason to see this movie, and half of its criticisms were about how the young, Oscar-nominated actress deserved better than this. Probably true. However, I will always have the utmost respect for a celebrated actor with Hollywood laid out at their feet who will still take on a role just because it's fun and a bit novel. Heck, Nicolas Cage has basically made a career out of that for the last 10 years. Respect. I like that the film acknowledges Veronica will be outmatched in almost every way in her first solo mission, in everything from physical strength and size to her knowledge of the terrain. Any one of these disadvantages could be disastrous for her, which is why she needs to surveil her targets, learn their weaknesses, and take steps to disorient them during the hunt. She's basically Batman.
Oh, you think darkness is your ally?
Could this movie be made today? Strong female character faces off against a truly diabolical depiction of a misogynistic white patriarchy, and defeats it without ever becoming a female character who requires rescuing because she don't need no man. The problem is that real men in the audience are cheering her on the entire time because real men like seeing the demise of evil men who abuse women. This invalidates the filmmaker's intention of making all men uncomfortable because filmmakers like this believe that Jameson's crew is an accurate depiction of all masculine men. So the movie is an irredeemable failure simply for the sin of entertaining both genders. Should have given it to Greta Gerwig.
There felt something sparky about it.
As human beings, we are free. Free to love, to hate, to fight, to kill.
There are 7 male characters in this movie. 4 are sociopathic serial killers, 1 is a handsy creep at a bar, 1 is a murderous hallucination during Veronica's drug trip, and 1 is a handsome, noble, intelligent, competent, and masculine mentor/love interest for the female lead. However, there are actual industry-standard postings in writers' rooms throughout Hollywood which specify that a male character can no longer mentor a woman or be her superior in any competence capacity. So this movie is ruined because number 7 undoes all the virtue-signaling good that was done by numbers 1 through 6. Should have given it to Greta Gerwig.
Our country should be more fearful of white men across our country because they are actually causing most of the deaths within this country. Sparky.
Although she definitely didn't go full T2 Sarah Connor, Abigail Breslin did do a significant amount of training in order to do her own stunts in this movie, including some fairly complicated fight choreography. However, according to MSNBC, fitness is a weapon of radicalization for the far right, so all women should be ugly and fat, and Abigail Breslin should be put into a FEMA camp. Wow! We went too far in the other direction! Cut to the hot Mexican weather girl!
Arriba!
Despite having resoundingly defeated the patriarchy, Veronica ends the movie by leaning into it because you cannot tell me that she is not throwing some serious doomy eyes at William here.
Down with the patriarchy.
Abigail Breslin is clearly struggling to get a sufficient amount of whipped cream on her finger for her finger-licking good pancake experience in this scene. Nothing less than half a tablespoon of whipped cream is acceptable for licking off a finger. This implies that the male director either didn't allow Abigail an extra take to scoop up the correct amount, or he's so incompetent at pancakes that he thought we wouldn't notice. Typical man.
I'm a pancake. I'm a pancake. Do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm a pancake.
I will also be auctioning off this bottle of Aunt Jemima syrup that still has the picture of a successful black female entrepreneur on the label before the saviors of the world remove her forever.
Why can't I just shoot them?
This is literally Abigail Breslin's first line in this movie, and it makes perfect sense from the viewpoint of a trained government assassin. Outside of my own headcanon, the honest answer to a question is probably, you're not working with the highest watt filmmakers and they need the rest of the story to happen. However, her suggestion that women require mechanical equalizers in order to take on an overwhelming force of physically superior male adversaries implies that the good guy with the gun philosophy has merit, and also that Disney, Marvel, and the Barbie movie are lying to an entire generation of impressionable young girls about their innate ability to be an ass-kicking girl boss by merit of nothing more than their existence, which basically makes Veronica a far-right extremist who needs to be put into a FEMA camp.
Drive by Barbie! Drive by Barbie! Whoa! Whoa! Drive by Barbie! Drive by Barbie! Yeah! Drive by Barbie! Let's go, Barbie!
Right. Googly! Woogly!
Even bad movies used to be good, even when they're teetering on the borderline between the good kind of bad and just flat-out bad. The difference between bad movies then and bad movies now is that bad movies then weren't made by people who hate you for the sole purpose of reminding you how much they hate you. They also weren't made by people who hate money. Even blue-haired people used to be sweet summer children with delusions of changing the world into a blue-haired utopia, but they weren't a bunch of retards who thought that people would actually pay them for it. They never loved us or our money as much as they loved themselves, but each slice of that love pie graph was still big enough that we could easily tune out the messaging and feel good about giving them our money. Final Girl is probably a movie about empowering feminism and toxic patriarchal masculinity. But nobody cared because it felt far more natural to view it as a movie about good versus evil with a vulnerable protagonist who has to battle her own fears and physical limitations to save the day. She kills the villains, she gets the prince, she eats pancakes. We don't demand much more from our movies than that. Anyway, should Christ tarry, I'll see you in the next video. Jesus loves you, vote Lane for King of Canada. If any little kids are watching this, there's a 10-hour loop of that I'm a Pancake song that your parents would be delighted for you to discover on YouTube at the link below. And let's make movies great again.
Put him on the endangered species list.
Come on, man.
I'm a pancake. I'm a pancake. Do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm a pancake. I'm a pancake. I'm a pancake. Do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm a pancake. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm a pancake. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm a pancake.